When you look up the documentation for how NumPy solves roots, you'll find that it says the root estimates are obtained as the eigenvalues of the companion matrix. But what are those? Well, NumPy has a function called polycompanion, which, given this example of the polynomial of 3x squared plus 2x plus 1, the first step it actually does is normalize everything, dividing by the leading coefficient. And then, when your polynomial is of this form, this is the structure of the companion matrix, resulting in the matrix of 0, negative a third, 1, negative 2/3. But then the other question we have is, well, what's an eigenvalue? And it's given by this equation. As an example, the eigenvalue of the matrix 0, 1, 1, 1 is the value of 1.618, and its eigenvector is 0.6181. It has another pair of eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and I discuss more about this in my video on power method, where I discuss power method, inverse power method with a shift, and the Rayleigh quotient iteration. I do recommend checking this video out. And then, going back to the eigenvalues of the companion matrix, here is the result that you get. And just to double check our work, for our polynomial of 3x squared plus 2x plus 1, plugging everything into the quadratic equation gives us that answer. But why though? If you take the eigenvalues of the companion matrix and leave everything in terms of coefficients, and we solve for the eigenvalues using the determinant approach, what we're left with is this polynomial of lambda squared plus the first coefficient times lambda plus the second one. If we then substitute in our own coefficients, what we're left with is these eigenvalues. But there's gotta be a better way, because root finding is already a challenge, and it gets even more complicated when you add matrices and linear algebra, requiring a lot of memory and things like matrix multiplication. There's gotta be something polynomial specific, and that's where Jenkins-Traubs comes in. Now, of course, there are other polynomial root finding methods out there, like Horner's method, Laguerre's method, Duran-Kerner, Aberth-Ehrlich, Graves' method, and Berezovskiy's method, but we're just going to stick to Jenkins-Traubs for now. This method was first published in A Three-Stage Variable Shift Iteration for Polynomial Zeros by Jenkins and Traubs, but before I actually dive into that paper, I actually need to discuss these two earlier papers by Traubs. Let's look at the one in the middle. In A Class of Globally Convergent Iteration Functions for the Solution of Polynomial Equations, Traubs laments that for Newton's method, there is no actual guarantee of convergence. Now, quick sidebar, if you use the Newton bisection hybrid or the global Newton method, those would converge, but those are other videos. He also notes that the polynomial would be undefined when the value of the derivative is zero. So he instead replaces the derivative of the polynomial with some other function v, where ideally v is the polynomial divided by x minus the root. Why? Well, if you did plug that into our Newton's method equation and simplify, this means our next value for our x is our root, hence we found the answer. Traubs' strategy is to construct a special polynomial, which he calls g, which actually starts with the derivative. Its next iteration for g is given by this equation. The reason this works is because the limit as our lambda, and confusingly lambda is also the eigenvalue, but we're not going to consider that, as the limit approaches infinity, g of lambda divided by its leading coefficient approaches the polynomial divided by x minus the root. Let's take an example of x squared minus x minus 1. Find g0, which is just 2x minus 1, its derivative. Its leading coefficient is 2, and plug everything in to find our value for g1, which is simply just x plus 2. Repeat the same process to find g2 of 3x plus 1, and eventually let's stop at g10 of 123x plus 76. Then, if we take our updated version of Newton's method, dividing instead of by the derivative, but rather g divided by its leading coefficient, where m is some sufficiently large number, let's just say 10, given our polynomial x squared minus x minus 1, topping at g sub 10 of 123x plus 76, its leading coefficient is 123, we get this form. Let's just pick a value for x0 and let it be 0, because it really doesn't matter where we start, and I'll show you why in a minute. Our next value for x is going to be 1.61842. Repeat the process, and our next value for x converges at 1.618. This approach will always converge on our largest root, and I'll come back to this in a moment. Once you do find the root, deflate using Horner's method, and restart until you found all the roots of your original polynomial. This method even works for complex roots, you just basically need to start with a complex number. Wilkinson, though, noted that it's actually better to deflate from the smallest root rather than the largest one for stability purposes. Which leads us to our next paper, the one on the right, the calculation of zeros of polynomials and analytic functions. Our new strategy is rather than our g function, we use an h function, starting again with the derivative. This is our form for our next value for h. The limit as h divided by its leading coefficient approaches infinity is the polynomial divided by x minus the smallest root. Just note the small comparison between our g and h polynomials. These are very different forms. Starting from our example polynomial of x squared minus x minus 1, finding our first value for h, which is, again, its derivative of 2x minus 1, plugging everything into our equation for h1, we get our next value for h is negative x plus 3. Repeat the process, h2 is 3x minus 4. Keep going, and we'll stop at h to the 10 of 123x minus 199. And the process is much the same as we did for our earlier method, except replacing now with our h polynomial, and again, we're assuming m is a large term. For our example again, of x squared minus x minus 1, h sub 10 is 123x minus 199. Our leading coefficient is 123, and plug everything in to update our form. Pick a starting value for x. Again, it really doesn't matter where you start. Let's just pick 0. Our next value for x is negative 0.618, and it converges after the next iteration. We'll also always find our smallest root. Once you do, deflate and restart until you found all of the roots. It even works on complex numbers. This approach is now numerically stable because we're dividing out by the smallest root. But what happens when there isn't a smallest root? This is where we come to Jenkins and Traub's paper. Start with Traub's H equation and make one small change in the second stage of our three-stage approach, including a shift S. So our H equation looks like this now. One thing to note is that this is actually equivalent to Traub when you pick an S of equal to 0. The authors write, shifting is incorporated in the algorithm itself in a natural and stable way. Shifting breaks equimodularity and speeds convergence. One bit of symmetry which you may have noticed is that power method always converges to our largest eigenvalue. Traub's G equation converged to our largest root. Inverse power method converged to our smallest eigenvalue, and Traub's H equation converges to our smallest root. The inverse power method with the shift converges to our closest guessed eigenvalue of mu, and our Jenkins-Traub H equation with the shift converges to the root nearest our shift. Well, kinda. For stability, Traub forces it to converge to our smallest root. Our first stage of the three-stage process is to actually apply Traub's H equation for a few iterations, seeding it to start heading to our smallest root. And then stage two actually starts with picking S as a random number inside of a circle in the complex plane with a lower bound radius of beta, where beta is found by performing Newton's method on a polynomial containing the same coefficients as the original polynomial, except each of them is now an absolute value. And Cauchy proved that beta would be the smallest root of the constructed polynomial and the only positive value. Also, if for whatever reason this doesn't work, restart with another random S. Which leads to my question of why? We're already trying to find the root of one polynomial. Why use Newton's method to find the root of another one? Why not just start with global Newton's method in that case? If we are really concerned about the smallest root, a few iterations of Graves' method would work. What's wrong with just allowing a starting guess? What if I actually wanted to find a root somewhere in the middle? What if I want to use this method to make fractals? What if we let h sub 0 just be the derivative and then skip stage 1, only applying now stage 2? And I'm just going to use this example polynomial from earlier videos, letting our starting guess be the value of 4. h0 just be the derivative, and then plug everything into our shifted h equation to find our value for x h1. Afterwards, h2. And stop at h sub 10. Then afterwards, let's plug in 4 using our updated Newton's equation with our new h to find our value for s1, and then s2, s3, and s4 converge on the value of 5. If we take the example polynomial of x to the 5th minus 8x to the 4th minus 72x cubed plus 32x squared plus 727x minus 2310. Traub's g equation would help us convert to our largest root of 11. Traub's h equation would find our smallest one at 2. And Jenkins-Traub, with skipping stage 1 and using a fixed stage 2 for our starting value of 4, converges on the root of 5. But what about this third stage? For that, Traub updates our h equation using our new value for s after every step. You can think of this as similar to the Rayleigh quotient iteration, where after you update your value for b, you then compute a new mu value and plug everything in. Here's what that third updating stage would look like. Rather than using a fixed value, we're actually going to just use one iteration of the fixed second stage. Starting with first our h0 being the derivative, using our first iteration of a fixed h, and then updating our value for s. This then leads us to update our value for h, to then update s again, update h, and update s. Eventually, this converges on the value of 5 for s. Jenkins and Traub were able to prove that the method is actually globally convergent, and that it is at least quadratic. We'll come back to that. The method is equivalent to the Rayleigh quotient iteration on a companion matrix, and a few key advantages are that there are no matrices nor linear algebra, there's no need for eigenvectors, there are no inverses, and the method is numerically stable, assuming you're deflating from the smallest root. And also, it doesn't mind about multiplicity or the distribution of your roots. Ford was able to prove in this paper, a generalization of the Jenkins-Traub method, that the order is 1 plus the golden ratio, or 2.618. And now, changing gears for a bit of story, I've actually been meaning to work on this video for quite a while, but things didn't actually click until I read Jenkins' dissertation, where, sidebar, his advisory committee was a real who's who of math folks at Stanford, including George Forsythe, who I mentioned in my video on Brent's method. In his dissertation, Jenkins provides algol code for this equation, or excuse me, for this method, which ended up being known as C-poly, colloquially. There's also another method he describes for when the coefficients are all real, later published in this paper, a three-stage algorithm for real polynomials in quadratic iteration, which became known as R-poly. If that is a video that you want me to make, let me know in the comments below. The example code that I wrote for this video is available on GitHub, and I actually wrote it in SymPy to make the writing and reading easier, but it is a little bit inefficient. I also then made fractals using this method by first skipping stage 1, just letting h be the derivative, and using the starting pixel in the complex plane as our guess for s, then doing one stage of stage 2, and afterwards just applying stage 3 until it converges. Note that I'm not coloring by the root, only in the number of iterations. This is the fractal that you get for the function of z cubed minus 1. And here is for the equation of z to the 8th plus 15z to the 4th minus 16. It's really interesting to compare both of these equations to the other fractals that I've generated with other methods. A few things to note are that you can find roots by using the eigenvalues of the companion matrix, and Traub's g polynomial is akin to the power method, while his h polynomial is akin to inverse power method. Jenkins-Traub's h shift behaves similar to the inverse power method with a shift, and applying the third stage makes it behave like the Rayleigh quotient iteration. Jenkins and Traub do one make small change, which is to force to converge to the smallest root, and the method avoids all forms of matrices in linear algebra. It also doesn't mind multiplicity or root distribution. The order for the Jenkins-Traub method is again 2.618. As always, thank you for watching. What really made this video take such a long time is that there aren't really any good resources for Jenkins-Traub, not even any other videos on YouTube. Most of the resources you'll find will just re-explain the paper, but if you're already confused about what the method does, rereading the paper doesn't really help. If you like this video, please show your support and let me know about any other topics you think I should cover.